Good day to everyone. Today we will be talking about the axial skeleton. No? If you say axial or axial, no, it is in the axis, longitudinal axis. If you are this, if this is your body. So we are talking about this part of the skeleton. Okay, that's why it's called axial, the axis, the longitudinal axis of the body. Okay, so it will be composed of the skull and the vertebrae. So the axial skeleton forms the longitudinal axis of the body. It is divided into three parts: skull, vertebral column, and the bony thorax. So if you look at here, no, so we have the skull here, and we have the bony thorax here, which is the chest, and we have the vertebral column. So these are the three major division of this axial skeleton. Okay. So if you look at the posterior part, this is the posterior part, and this is the anterior part. Okay. So let us talk first with the first division, the skull. Okay, so the skull is this one. Okay, so the skull is two sets of bones, no? They have two sets, the cranium and the facial bone. So this is now the cranium, and this is now your facial bone. Okay. So bones are joined by sutures. So there are suture lines that you can see. So here, here, here. Okay, so there are suture lines that you can see on the skull. Actually, the skull is not actually a solid one or a complete bone, but skull is divided into many different bones, okay? And if you notice that it is the only the mandible that is attached freely to a movable joint. So this is the joint, no? This joint is movable. Okay, so this is the only, we have here also, no? The only bone in the skull that is freely attached, that is attached freely to a movable joint. Okay, siya lang yan. So, this is now your mandible. Yung panga mo, yan, panga. Okay? So, let's go to the cranium. Okay? Cranium is a box-like, this is the description, no? And composed of eight. So, we have eight large flat bones. Remember, it's flat. And except there are two sets of paired, no, and the rest are single bones. Okay, so the paired part of the cranium or the parietal bone, so we have here the green one, okay, and the temporal bone, which is the orange one. Of course, these are paired. We have the right and the left at the back, no? And this temporal bone is also right and left. So the rest is in one piece or a single bone. Okay? So remember, we have eight. Two are paired. The paired one are parietal and the temporal bone. Okay. Let's talk about frontal bone. So this yellow, I think. Yellow. Okay. This is now the frontal bone. Forms the forehead. Okay, kagaya ko malaki yung forehead. The bony projections under the eyebrow. So if you look at the bony projection on the eyebrow until here, no. That is the part of your frontal bone. Okay, and the superior part of its eye orbit. So the eye orbit has so many different facial bones that are connected here. but the frontal bone is considered part of the skull. Okay? Not part of the facial bone. So, our skull is until here. Okay? So, this one is a part of the skull and it is a part of the cranium. I should say. This is a part of the cranium, not part of the facial bone. Sorry. So, this is a part of our cranium and it's not a part of facial bone. Okay. So, this is part of the cranium. Okay, sometimes, if this is not a part of the facial bone, so the facial bone is only until here. Okay? Parietal bones. Okay, so parietal bones are paired bones. So, paired bones form the most superior, meaning uppermost portion, and also the lateral walls of the cranium. So, if you look at the skull, actually this is the roof of the skull, no, and it is paired left and right, so it also forms the lateral superior, sa side sa taas, ibig sabihin lateral superior of the skull, no, of the cranium. And then if you look at here, there are many sutures associated with this one, no. First is the sagittal suture. Since the parietal bones are paired, if you look at here, no, there is a suture line that is dividing the two parietal bone. Okay, so we have this sagittal suture, okay, in the midline where two parietal bones meet, no, and another one is the coronal suture. So the coronal suture is this one, no, that divides the frontal bone and the parietal bone. Okay, so coronal suture is formed where paired parietal bones meet the frontal bone. So that is the coronal suture. So temporal bones, of course, we also learned this one in our discussion previously, no. So temporal bones, this orange one. Okay? So, lie inferior to the parietal bone, meaning at the bottom or below the parietal bone, is what we call temporal bone. And it was joined them at the squamous suture. So, this is now the squamous suture. Okay? So, this is the squamous suture. So, we have sagittal suture, coronal suture, squamous suture. Okay, and there are several important markings that appear on the temporal bone. And they are very important in nursing, no? So, we need to memorize them and analyze them where they are located. Okay? So, first important bone markings. We have the external acoustic meatus. If you look at this, this is where the ear canal flows and going to the eardrum, no? So, yan yung butas natin papunto. Remember, the ear canal is part of the bony labyrinth in the temporal bone. So, papasok yan dyan hanggang sa eardrum. Okay? It's a canal and leads to the eardrum and in the middle ear. And is route by which sound enters the ear. Okay? So, it is the route. Okay? Daanan ng sound wave until it reaches the tympanic membrane, and then the tympanic membrane will vibrate and move these three bones, yung code natin, no, HAS, okay, so until it hits the inner ear where the cochlea and vestibule are located. Okay, so this is very important structure, no, external acoustic meatus. Another one is this styloid process. Okay, if you say process in the bones, these terms are used for the extensions. Okay, extensions and protrusions. You can see that this one protrudes. from the temporal bone. So this is called process. All extensions and protrusion are called processes, no? So we have this styloid process, which is like a needle, but this is very important, no? This has a important role in our movement. Okay, a sharp needle projection just inferior to the external auditorium hiatus sa baba, no, inferior. Many neck muscle, yan, neck muscles use the styloid process as an attachment point. So, neck muscles are attached here for movement. So, we can move our head, no? Our neck, because muscles are attached here. Okay. So, we have two styloid muscle. Do you think if this one is broken, you can move your neck? You have difficulty, no? And there, it's very painful. Remember, it's very small. Okay, so take care of this one, no? Yan. Another one is zygomatic process. Remember, this is the zygomatic, no? Zygomatic is the cheekbone. Okay, the zygomatic is joined in the temporal bone by this process called zygomatic process. But this zygomatic process is not part of the zygomatic bone, but it's a part of the temporal bone. It is an extension or protrusion from the temporal bone, which is very thin po yung thin. Okay, thin bridge. Yun ang description niya. If you look at the side view, pag ganun kasi yan. Eh. Meron siyang ganun. Tapos, ito na yung cheekbone. No? Ganyan. So, ayan na yung bony labyrinth. Ay, yung ano, bony labyrinth. Yan na yung bony orbit. Okay. So, that is the zygomatic process. A thin bridge of bone that joins the cheekbone or the zygomatic bone. Okay? So, did you understand? Okay, so another important bone marking is the mastoid process. Again, it mastoid process, extension or protrusion. So, this one, no? This one. And this is very important. So, take care of your ear, no? It has air, no? It is full of air cavities and it is wrapped projection posterior, meaning at the back. Okay, and inferior at the back and below of the external acoustic meatus. Okay, so if you look at here, posterior, inferior, here is the location of your mastoid process. It provides an attachment site for some muscles of the neck. So these two are important for movement of our head, no? And because this one is filled with air and cavities. Okay. Sometimes, because of frequent ear infection, this mastoid process could be infected. No. If there is infection of the mastoid, it's called mastoiditis. Okay. And since this one has direct contact with the brain, infection of the mastoid could also infect the brain. That's why be careful with your ear. So if you have a ear problem, consult the doctor. Okay, infection of the ear is called otitis media. So if you experience always otitis media, you will also experience mastoiditis. That could also infect your brain and it's very dangerous, no? So that's very important to know. Okay? Another markings is the jugular foramen. Okay? Jugular foramen, this one. By the word jugular, this one is jugular veins enter this one, no? To drain the blood from the brain, no? So blood coming from the brain will go back to the heart. Okay? Via this foramen. Via the jugular vein, and the jugular vein pass through this channel or tube or passageway called the jugular foramen. Okay, The junction of the occipital and temporal lobe. So, at the junction. Okay? This one allows the passageway of jugular vein, the largest vein of the head, which drains the blood from the brain. Actually, you can see your vein, no, at the neck, especially if you are trying hard singer and bumibirit ka ng todo, makikita mo yung ugat, and that is the jugular vein. And the jugular vein passes here so that the unoxygenated blood will be drained going back to the heart for oxygenation. Okay, so another one is the internal acoustic meatus. So inside the temporal bone, because the vestibulocochlear are located there. So vestibular cochlear nerve that is connected to that, no, must also have a channel or entrance point going to the brain for interpretation at the auditory cortex of the temporal lobe. Okay, so daanan po ng cranial nerves to. So, transmit cranial nerves number 7 and number 8, which is the facial and vestibulocochlear nerves, entering this channel going to our auditory cortex of our temporal lobe for interpretation. Okay, we have the carotid canal. So, outside, you can see the carotid canal through which the internal carotid artery runs, supplying the blood most of the brain. The carotid artery can be found in the large artery that can be palpated at your neck. The one that is beating, tug, 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 that is your artery, no? Carotid artery. It will enter here and go to your brain to supply your brain with new fresh blood. Okay? So, that is the entrance of the carotid artery. So, another part or large part bone, part of the cranium is the occipital bone. No? So, this is the occipital bone. If you look at the cranium, the occipital bone is located at the most posterior part, meaning nasa likod, no? Batok mo. Okay? And this one contains our cerebellum, the organ for, or the center for balance. Okay? The organ for balance is the vestibule. So, the center for balance. So, it was located here. And actually, this is now the bottom, no? The floor of the cranium. So, the most posterior bone of the cranium and forms the base and back wall of the skull, no? So this is the base and also the back wall of the skull, and joins the parietal bones anteriorly at the lambdoid suture. So this is the lambdoid suture now. Okay? Another one is So, in occipital bone, like the temporal bone, there are also important markings. So, first is the foramen magnum. Okay? Meaning large hole. If you look at here, there is a large hole here, no? So, this one surrounds the lower part of the brain and allows the spinal cord to connect with the brain. So, this is the hole for the spinal cord to enter the brain, no? So this is the entrance of the spinal cord in order to reach the brain in the cranium. Okay. Another important bone markings in the occipital lobe is the occipital condyles, no? So lateral to the foramen magnum, we have these two, no? Yan. Okay, so the description is, it's like rocker-like. Okay, kung this is the rocker chair na, if this is the chair, yan. Upuan kunyari yan, no? So, meron siyang rocker. If you look at this one, this is a rocker-like, okay, which rests on the first vertebrae of the spinal column. So, nakapatong siya dun sa first vertebrae so that the head could move, okay. Another part of the cranium is the sphenoid bone. So, the pink one, no, it shapes like a butterfly. So, that is the description of this sphenoid bone, no? Sphenoid bones expands with the width of the skull. So, it expands in the width of the skull and forms part of the floor of the cranial cavity. So, it is one of the floor also of the cranial cavity. Okay, if you can see what is the composition of the floor, no? It is the sphenoid bone, temporal bone, and occipital bone. So, parietal and frontal bone are not included to the floor, but they are the roof because they are the superior part of this cranium. Okay, so these are the parts of the cranium that forms the basement or the floor of the cranium or cranial cavity. Okay, important bone markings. One is cilia torsica or Turk saddle. Cilia means chair, no? So, Turk saddle. Okay, which forms a snug enclosure for the pituitary gland. So, ito. So, pituitary gland are located here or is located here. Okay. Another important bone markings in this sphenoid bone is the foramen ovale. So, if you look at here, there are three holes here, no? So, this is the foramen ovale. Large oval opening in line with the posterior end of the cilia torsica. Okay. Allows the fiber of the cranial nerve number 5, the trigeminal, to pass to the chewing muscle of the lower jaw or mandible. Okay, so this is a passageway of cranial nerve number 5, the trigeminal. No? And then we have the optic canal, allows the optic nerve to pass through the eye for interpretation. And we have the superior orbital fissures, okay, a slit-like through which the cranial nerves controlling the eye movement. You have the intrinsic muscle, no? Extrinsic muscle of the eye. The one that is controlling it is the number 3, number 4, and number 6. Okay? So, another structure here in the sphenoid bone is the sphenoidal sinuses. Okay, so we have sphenoidal sinuses on this part. This one is to lighten the skull, okay, and make the sound that we create resonance. So all of the sinus cavity here makes our sound resonance, no? And make the skull lighter. Okay, let's go now to the fifth, no? Cranial bone, the ethmoid bone. So, ethmoid bone is here. I think this is a lighter brown until here. So, that is the ethmoid bone. Very irregular shape and lies anterior to the sphenoid. Okay? So, in front of the sphenoid. It forms the roof of the nasal cavity. So, this is the one that we should always know. That the roof of the, if this is the nose, no? This is the nasal cavity. The roof of the nasal cavity is the ethmoid bone. Okay? And part of the medial walls of the orbit. So, the medial walls of the orbit. Ito yung, this is your orbit. So, we have medial walls. So, they are located in the medial walls of the bony orbit. No? So, important bone markings here. So, if we cut the skull in this kind of structure, no, cross section, we can find the Crista Galli. Okay? This is projecting from superior surface. Literally called coxcomb. Okay, yun naman yung tawag sa kanya. No? And then, the outermost covering of the brain attaches to this projection. Okay? The outermost covering of the brain attaches to this projection. The dura mater, no? Another one is cribriform plates. So we have plates here, no? On each side of the crista galli are many small holes. So the holes here, the holy areas, allow the nerve fibers carrying impulse, of course the olfactory nerve, no, from the olfactory receptors of the nose to reach the brain. So this is the exit point or entrance point of the olfactory nerve going to the olfactory lobe, no, cortex, for the interpretation in our brain. So there are also extensions of the ethmoid bone. Okay, we have the superior nasal conchae. Okay, superior nasal conchae and middle nasal conchae. Actually, the middle nasal conchae is this one, no? And we have superior there. Okay, form part of the lateral walls of the nasal cavity. Okay, so there are lateral walls of the nasal cavity that contains the conchae. So we have this nasal conchae. Okay, let's move now to facial bone. Now on the facial bone, a while ago, the frontal bone is part of the cranium. So this is part of the cranium, the frontal bone. So we will separate this one now. So if we move here, we cut here. Okay, so that is only our facial bone. So the first one is the maxillae or maxillary bones. Okay, maxillae or maxillary bones. So maxillary, I should say, maxillary bones fused to form the upper jaw. So they are fused. These two are fused. No, if you look at this one, this is paired. No, they fuse to form the upper jaw. And take note, all facial bones except mandible, join the maxillae or maxillary bone. Thus, they are main or keystones. Okay, keystone bones of the face. So, all of the facial bone are connected here except this mandible. Okay, that's why it's called keystone. Okay, the maxillae carry the upper teeth in the alveolar process. So these are the alveolar process. No? There are extensions there and they are called alveolar process. Also in the mandible, we have that one. Okay. So extensions of the maxillae or maxillary bone. First is the palatine process. So we have palatine process here. Okay, form the anterior part of the hard palate of the mouth. Okay, and here inside the maxillary bone or maxillae, we have the paranasal sinuses. So we have the maxillary or maxillae sinus. So inside there are also spaces or cavity filled with air. Okay, which drain into the nasal passages, whose nasal cavity, and lighten the skull, bones, and amplify the sounds that we make as we speak. So that is the purpose of our sinuses, no? Next is palatine bones. Okay, so we have palatine bones. A paired palatine bones lie inferior to the palatine process of the maxillae. I have already discussed this one. Okay, so this was repeated, no? Failure of this or the palatine process to fuse medially result in the cleft palate. Okay. Alam niyo yung cleft palate, yung tinatawag na mimiyak, no? Mimiyak sa loob, no? So if you look at the palate, they are open. That's why they have difficulty of pronouncing words, no? Or their sounds of pronouncing word is different. Para silang ngongo. Okay? Next of the facial bone is the zygomatic bone. So, medyo may error tayo sa zygomatic bone. The arrow should be here, no? This one. This is the zygomatic bone. Okay? Zygomatic bone are commonly referred to as the cheekbones. Okay, so they are the cheekbone. Yung iba, magaganda yung cheekbone. They have prominent cheekbone that shapes their face, no? Mga model. Ako, walang cheekbone. Mataba yung pisngi ko eh. Okay, so they also form a good size portion of the lateral walls of the orbit. So if you look at the orbit, no, orbital area, no. If you look at the lateral walls, actually it is composed of the zygomatic bone. Oh, kita niyo yung lateral walls niya. So it has a very wide or good size portion of the lateral walls. Yan. Okay? Lacrimal bones. By the word lacrimal, no? The lacrimal bones are fingernail-sized bones. Okay? Ito siya, no? Yung tingnan mo to, oh, this one. Okay? Forming the part of medial wall of its orbit. Okay? Just like the sphenoid, no? Or the ethmoid. Yan. From the medial part. Ethmoid, I should say, not sphenoid, no? So, each lacrimal bone has a groove that serve as passageway for tears, no? So, if you remember in our spatial senses on the eye, we have the canaliculi. So, the canaliculi will follow this groove, okay, going out to the nasal cavity. So, we have also the lacrimal duct that is located here, no? And if this one is occluded, okay, if you have sinusitis also and this one is occluded, usually your tears goes to your eyes, no? Goes out. Ayan. So, nasal bones. The small rectangular bone, this one, no? Okay? Forming the bridge of the nose are the nasal bones. The lower part of the skeleton of the nose is made up of the hyaline cartilage. So, if this is your nose, nasal bone, okay, the lower part is made up of hyaline cartilage. So, there are some who has, who doesn't have this one, no? Yung mga pango, ang lambot-lambot lang ng ilong dito. There's no cartilage. But there are some also who has large nose na nakakatakot na rin tingnan, no? So, yung medium size, maganda rin tingnan. Okay, another part of the facial bone is the bomer bone. Okay? So, it is a single bone in the midline of the nasal cavity. So, yung bone na yan, no? The nasal cavity. So, the bomer, word bomer means plow or araro. Mga estudyante ngayon, hindi na nakakakita ng araro. Hindi alam yung araro. It refers to the bone's shape, no? It is shaped like a plow. That's why the name is bomer. Okay? The bomer forms the inferior part of the bony nasal septum, which separates the two nostrils. That's why we have left and right nostril. And if you look at the internal or nasal cavity, you can see a division between the right and left. Okay? That is the responsibility of our bomber bone. Okay, another one is the inferior nasal conchae. So this one is the inferior nasal conchae. No, are thin, curved bones projecting medially from the lateral walls of the nasal cavity. Yeah. Okay, so number 8 is the mandible or the lower jaw. So the lower jaw is big, no? I think this is the largest part of the facial bone. It's big, no? So the largest and strongest bone of the face joins the temporal bone on each side of the face. If you look at the side part of the face, forming only freely movable joints in the skull. So this is the only free movable joints in the skull. No? Another structure in our head is the hyoid bone, but this is not part of the skull. No? It is closely related to the mandible and temporal bone. Okay? It is unique in that it is the only bone that does not articulate with any other bone. So it is freely hanging and it is connected to many muscles. Okay? Suspended in neck, mid-neck region about 2 cm above your larynx or the voice box, where it is anchored by ligaments on the styloid process. Oh, take note, they are also connected to the styloid process of the temporal bone. And the shape is horseshoe shape. Okay? With a body of 2 pairs of horns, the hyoid bone serves as movable base for the tongue. So the tongue is also connected to the hyoid bone. And it is at the attachment point of the neck muscle that arise in the lower larynx when we swallow and speak. So attachment of many muscles also. So these are the structure. Okay. You review them for your exam. Maybe the final exam includes these parts, no? So paranasal sinuses. Paranasal sinuses are cavities in our skull, no? They are hollow portion of bones surrounding the nasal cavity. So functions of paranasal sinuses is to lighten the skull because it contains air, no, cavity, and give resonance and amplification to our voice. So if these nasal paranasal sinuses are being clogged, okay, you will your voice will change like this, no?
Frontal sinus, ethmoid sinus, sternal sinus, maxillary sinus.
So they are the one responsible for giving us a good sound. Okay. Okay, so sometimes if you experience sinusitis or inflammation of this sinus, you feel pain at your forehead because one are located here, no? In the frontal lobe, okay, and then also in the ethmoid sinus and sphenoid sinus, okay, and in the maxillary. So sometimes in this part of your head is also painful because it is clogged, okay. So that's the hyoid bone. Okay, the fetal skull. The fetal skull is very important to understand also. During the newborn care, no, when you will be on your second year, okay, you will assist in the delivery of the newborn, okay, and you will measure the newborn with the length, okay, the head circumference, the length, arm circumference, abdominal circumference, and thigh circumference, and also the weight. So One of our duty is to perform this anthropometric measurement of the newborn, no? Okay, the fetal skull is large compared to the infant's total body length, no? So, if you are inside the mother's womb, your head is like this, and this is your body. So, your head is longer than your body, okay? Fetal skull is 1/4 of the body length compared to the adult skull, which is 1/8 of the body length. Fontanelles are fibrous membranes connecting to the cranial bones. No? So in the fetal skull, since the bones are not yet connected to each other hardly, no? Okay. These suture lines are called fontanelles. So they are fibrous membranes connecting the cranial bones. Okay, so why are they not yet connected to each other? It's because to allow the skull compression during birth. So adjustable yung ulo, no? If they will pass to the pelvic inlet and they will pass to the birth canal, the head will be allowed to be compressed during delivery and allow the brain to grow during later pregnancy and infancy. Okay? So, convert to bone within 24 months after birth. So, these fontanelles are not yet closed until 2 years. No? That is why be careful if you have a baby, no? Now, ganito. So, this is the anterior fontanelle and this is the posterior fontanelle. Usually, this one closed first and then followed by this one. So, sabi niya dyan, 24 months. No? So, 2 years in the making if they close. Okay? That's why, be careful if you have baby, no? Meron silang tinatawag na bumbunan. Bukas pa ang bumbunan, so be careful with your baby. I experienced last time, no, maybe 10 years ago, when we are having community duty, one of the father rushed his baby to the hospital because of accident. Okay? Because in the rural areas, usually the farmers, no, with the small house, if this is their bahay kubo, no, okay, they put their bolus and sharp objects on top and they sleep here. So the baby is sleeping here. Suddenly, this bolo drops on the head, hitting this one, penetrating the fontanelle. So they rush it in the hospital, but it is dead on arrival. So be careful because you get pregnant for 9 months, taking care of your fetus inside your womb, and then get out from your womb and take care for how many months, and then suddenly this will happen. So be careful, no? Protect your child. Okay? So let's continue. The next part is the vertebral column. So this is now at the back of your body, no, supporting our body. So this is the vertebral column of the human body. So each vertebrae is given a name according to its location. So cervical, okay, vertebrae, cervical vertebrae. So that's the name, no? Cervical vertebrae is the neck. Okay? Thoracic vertebrae, in which we have 12 thoracic vertebrae, it is on the thorax. Lumbar vertebrae, it is on the back, no? Okay, plank area. And then we have the sacral and coccyx at the bottom, no? Saddle natin, sa upuan, saddle. Okay, so we have the coccyx. So we have 7. We have 12, we have 5, and this one, total of 9. Okay? 5 and 4. Memorize that one, no? It's very important to memorize this structure, especially the number. Madali lang naman, it's very easy lang naman. So 7, 12, okay, 5, then 5, 4. 5, 5, 4. Okay, sacral and coccyx. Actually, this two was joined together. Okay. So, that's the vertebral column. So, 9 vertebrae fused to form the two composite sacrum and coccyx. Okay? So, during our, when we were newborn, okay, when we were infant, okay, the shape of our vertebrae is what we call primary curvatures. Okay, the spine curvatures of the thoracic and the sacral present from birth, no, form the C-shaped curvature as a newborn. Tingnan mo yung ano natin is C, no? Okay, secondary curvatures are the spinal curvatures of the cervical lumbar region. So, if you look at the as you go older, magkakaroon ka ng magiging S yan, no? Ganyan. And then, kakaroon ng ganun. So, letter S. No? Buha ka ng S. So, we will have this curvature develop after birth and forms an S-shaped curvature as an adult. Yan. Okay? So, these are three conditions, abnormal condition on the vertebrae. Okay? In order to memorize this one, it's very easy, no? So, scoliosis S, letter S. So, they form letter S, abnormal, lateral. Okay? Laterally abnormal. Okay? Kyphosis, kyphosis, kuba. Okay, kuba. Okay? Lordosis, liad. Nakaliad mo. So, here, in scoliosis, usually these are conditions developed during childhood, no? If you remember, if you look at the shoulder, no, they are uneven. Uneven yung shoulder niya. So, there is an even shoulder and even the hips, no? They are not even also. And this is most of the study before is due to the bags that we are using when we were a child, no? Yung shoulder bag, okay, bawal na yan, because it carries weight unevenly, no? So, matatabi yung shoulder mo, especially if you have osteoporosis already. Even the trolley, no? The trolley bag. Actually, the trolley bag is effective. Okay, if no trolley bag, it is used in the correct way, no. So if you push your trolley bag, it's better than pulling it one hand. So if you pull it one hand, there will be an even force again carrying your luggage, no, or your bag. So I think the proper way is to hold him, to hold this one here and push your trolley. And that's the correct way. Okay? And also another solution that they have created before is the bag pack, no? Going to school, you have bag pack. Okay? That's the another way that they do, no? Because it will carry the bag evenly. But there are some students or even me sometimes, I carry the backpack with one shoulder only. And it's not good because it will cause you scoliosis. Sabihin naman, nakakasira kasi ng forma. They are not developed for fashion. They are developed for protection of the body against scoliosis. Okay, so yun yung scoliosis, kyphosis. And sometimes, no, for the scoliosis, if you are female, makikita mo, aside from the shoulder, no, yung shoulder ng babae, uneven, Pag nagsuot siya ng palda, yung palda niya uneven din. Mas mataas yung kabila. Okay, so that's what you can see. So if you examine the vertebrae, actually the vertebrae can be dismantled, no? Napapaghiwalay mo yan. Okay, you can separate them. So the main parts is the body, no? Then we have the vertebral arch, which contain the pedicle and the lamina. This is the pedicle and we have the lamina. Okay? Then we have the vertebral foramen, a large hole for the passageway of our spinal cord. Transverse process is this one. Actually, the vertebrae are connected to each other. If you look at the connection, these are the connection to the next vertebrae. So, spinous process at the back. Okay, this is a structure that you can see at the back, at the midline of the back, no? Superior and inferior articular process. So, this is the superior articular process and a facet. That one, no? Yung dugtungan. And we have also at the inferior. Hindi lang nakita dito. Okay? So, we have the atlas and the axis. So, this is the atlas, the one that is connected to your head already. Ayan. This is the one connected to your skull. If you remember, the rock-like portion of that one is seated here. Okay? And then, we have the axis. You can determine the shape is different, no? So this is more rounded, bigger, and this is heart-shaped. Okay? And then we have the cervical, typical cervical vertebrae. If you look at the cervical vertebrae after the axis, no? They are almost all the same. The structure are like this. Okay? So their structure is like this. Okay, the thoracic vertebrae, the structure is like this. They look like giraffe, no? And for the lumbar vertebrae, they look like the animal moose. And then the sacrum and the coccyx, which are joined together, no? If you look at this one. So, this is the sacrum formed by the fusion of the 5 vertebrae, and then the coccyx formed by the fusion of 3 to 5 vertebrae. So, in ano nila, average nila into 4, no? Which is called tailbone or remnant of the tail of the other vertebrates. Okay, that have tail. Ayan. So, meron tayong buntot ang tawag sa ating coccyx. Okay, sacrum and coccyx. Okay, so before I forget, no, so for the administration of anesthesia, okay, if this is your lumbar vertebrae, we have the L1 until L5, no. They are going to introduce your anesthesia in between the L4 and the L5. Because, okay, your spinal cord ends at the L1 and L2. So, to prevent heating the spinal cord, they administer the anesthesia on the L4 and L5. So, a spinal needle is being inserted inside, and they will release the anesthesia there. Okay? So, the bony thorax. Okay, forms a cage to protect the major organ. So, this is now your bony thorax. Okay? Consists of 3 parts, sternum, ribs, and the thoracic vertebrae. So, the whole of this one is the thoracic cage, no? If you look at the thoracic vertebrae, if you look at the first rib, the first rib is connected to the first thoracic vertebrae. And we have 12 ribs. That's why we have 12 also thoracic vertebrae. So, until here, no? The first 7 is called the true ribs because the 7 ribs are connected to the sternum, no? They are connected to the sternum. Look at the first one. Connect. This is the sternum. Okay? So, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, no? And the 8, 9, 10, 11, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, sorry. 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Okay, the 12 are called false ribs because they are not directly connected to the sternum. And two of the false ribs, the 11 and 12, are called floating ribs. Okay, because they are not connected already to the rest of the ribs, no? So only the 10 ribs are connected to each other, but the 11 and 12, they do not connect to the rest of the ribs. That's why they are called floating ribs. Okay, and they are also part of our false rib. Just remember that true ribs are 7 because they are directly in contact with the sternum. Okay? So, there are also important structure that we should remember. And during our health assessment, these are very important structure in our sternum that we should remember. The jugular nuts, okay, later on you can see that one. External angle, why is called external angle? Because this sternum creates an angle here, no? So there's an angle here. External angle. So this is the head of the sternum, which is called manubrium, and this is the body. And then we have the xiphoid process here, in which in between the body of the sternum and the xiphoid process is called sub sternal joint. Okay, and consider also the location of this one, no? For the jugular nuts, it is in the line of T3. Okay, external angle, the line of T4. And then, sub sternal joint in line with T9. Okay. So, let's continue. So, sternum. Let's now talk about sternum. So, sternum is the flat bone at the center of your chest. So, this is the whole sternum until here, no? So, that is the sternum. Typically, a flat bone and the result of fusion of three bones. So, we have the manubrium, the body, and the xiphoid process. So, this is the manubrium, the whole of this. Okay? And then, this is the body, and this is the xiphoid process. Okay? Actually, you can palpate your sternum, try to palpate the manubrium, the body, and the xiphoid process. Okay, so it is attached directly to the first 7 pairs of ribs, which is called true ribs, by a costal cartilage. So these are costal cartilage, no? Okay, so this one, sternum, is very popular in your health assessment. Okay. So, they will be always a reference for your assessment in the chest area. So, when you assess the chest area, especially when you're assessing the location of the heart, the bulbs of the heart, your point of reference is your sternum. Okay? Example, this is the External border. Ito yung tinatawag na external border. You can read there, sasabihin doon that right external border. So this is the external border, right external border, and this is the left external border. So you are going to put your stethoscope there. It depends on what space, no? Intercostal space. Okay, so the space between these ribs are called intercostal space. Okay, so first there are important bony landmarks. No, first is the jugular nuts. Okay, so the jugular nuts is this one. No? There is a curvature here. Actually, you can palpate this one. Okay, you can palpate it, and there's a nuts here. Okay, a concave upper border of the manubrium can be palpated easily, and generally it is at the level of the third thoracic vertebrae. So nasa level siya ng third thoracic vertebrae, as I have mentioned a while ago when we illustrated it, it is at the level of the third thoracic vertebrae. Another landmark is the sternal angle. So this is now the sternal angle, the one that we identified a while ago at the lateral view of the thorax, no, of the sternum. Okay, results where the manubrium and the body meet at the slight angle to each other. So yung kanina yung nakita natin na nakaganon. So here we have the manubrium and we have the external body, no, and they meet here. So this one is the external angle. Okay, so that the transverse ridge is formed at the level of the second rib. So nasa second rib. Okay, so yan yung second rib natin. That's why, no, this external angle provides a handy reference point for counting ribs located at the second intercostal space. So pag nakapa mo yan, that is already your second intercostal space, and this is the first. Okay? So you know already the second intercostal space, and listening to certain heart valves. So heart valves are already located here. Okay. Another structure is the zip external joint. Okay, so this is now your zip external joint now. Actually, if you are performing ECG and also if you are locating the apex of the heart, it's very easy to locate using this reference point, no. Hawakan mo yung sternum mo, and then mahahawakan mo yung xiphoid process mo in between, that is the zip external joint. Now you draw a line going to the left, and also on your clavicle, if this is your clavicle, no? If this is your clavicle, draw a line, mid-clavicular line. Okay, measure the middle of your clavicle using your finger, and then draw a line going down, meeting now your line from your zip external joint. This is now the apex of your heart. So that is one way of finding it, because sometimes, especially if you are locating the apex of the heart for female, no, some of them has big breasts, okay, and it's difficult to palpate, no, pag malaki yung suso. So what you are going to do is to draw a line like that, no? And ask the mother to raise the breast so that you can palpate and put the stethoscope on the exact point, maximum point of impulse, para makuha mo yung counting of it, no? So, the point where the external body and xiphoid process fuse lies at the level of the ninth thoracic vertebrae naman sa kanya. Okay? So that's it. Okay, so let's go to the jugular nuts. If you look at this one, this is the T3 external angle, T4. and the zip sternal joint at the T9. Okay. So let's go now to the ribs. Okay, so sternum and then the ribs. There are 12 pairs form the walls of the bony thorax. So they form the walls of the bony thorax. All ribs articulate with the vertebral column. So lahat sila, they articulate to the vertebral column. Kaya nga sabi natin kanina is 12 ribs, 12 vertebrae, thoracic vertebrae. Okay, so one vertebrae to one pair of ribs. Okay? Posteriorly, at the back, and towards the anterior body surface. So, paikot, no? 7 are actually connected to the sternum and 3. Okay? Still connect to the ribs, but 2 are floating, 11 and 12. Okay, through ribs, the first 7 pairs attach directly to the sternum by costal cartilage. So if you look at here, there are cartilage. No? False ribs, the next 5 pairs either attach indirectly to the sternum or are not attached to the sternum at all. Okay? So, this one are not attached already. So, the last 2 pairs of false rib lack external attachment. Okay? And they are also called floating ribs. So, there are no external attachment already. That's why they are called floating ribs, but they are also called false ribs. So, there are 2 types of false rib. The 3 are still fused on the true ribs. On the sternum, but indirectly used, no? But the 2 floating ribs are not attached anymore to the sternum. Okay, the intercostal space in which they contain the intercostal muscle and external muscle, no? So there are muscles here that connects each ribs. Every time we breathe, it changes, no? So there is a rhythm that it is being followed, no? Okay, so we summarize this one. We have true ribs, we have 7 pairs, false rib, we have 5 pairs, and we have 2 floating ribs. Okay? And we have the thoracic vertebrae. So the bony thorax composed of sternum, and the sternum is this one that is composed of the manubrium body and xiphoid process. And we have the external angle, we have the jugular nuts, and we have the zip sternal joint. Okay? So